Welcome back for another Super Magnet Man video. This time we're going to talk about an interesting subject that, interestingly enough, over the last few weeks we have had quite a few customer calls that have involved this subject in explaining their solution to their application. And so I want to take a little bit of time and document a little bit about what it means when we talk about the magnetic gradient as opposed to the magnetic flux. We're usually understanding the flux because that's what we read off of a Gauss meter, but we want to understand a gradient, and then we'll wrap up by talking about how that affects our applications. So the first thing is, we're just going to show it in a picture here. If I look close to a magnet, the surface of a magnet, I am going to see the magnet coming off like this. And so if I followed this line all the way out, I would be reading 50 Gauss, or in this case, this might be 2,000 Gauss, 5,000 Gauss, whatever it is, I'm reading that until the field curves and goes back to the other side and connects with the other side. When we get a sufficient distance away from the magnet, the field looks more like this. And so what you end up with is like a 20 Gauss reading here. We may have to cover quite a bit of distance in getting closer to get to a 30 Gauss. And then it's less distance to go to 40, 50, 60, and then the lines get closer and closer as we look at it. So we're going to take a look now at this setup that I've got. The setup I've got is I've got a 2-inch cube, which will give us a very large, powerful magnetic field. This is the Gauss meter, and I have the probe here. If you look at the Gauss meter, you'll notice that my X direction, and the way this is oriented, the X measurement is in this direction. The Z is in this. Normally we'd think the Z is this way, but the way this probe is oriented, the Z is in this direction. The Y is up and down. So when we look at the Gauss meter, we see that we have a close to a zero on X and a zero on Z, but Y is not a zero. To make sure that we're reading and our instrument is just reading what we're seeing here, we'll put the little zero Gauss chamber on it, and you notice that for all practical purposes, we go to 0.1, 0.23 on that, 0.5 on the Y, 0.006 on the Z-axis. So we're pretty much zero. And we're reading a 20 Gauss straight down. The other two zeros, X and Z, indicate that we have got this pretty well centered from a magnetic field standpoint. Now we're going to start lowering it. And notice, looking at my calibrated scale, I'm at 45. And let's just go down until we hit the 30. And you can see how much we're having to move it to get us up to 30 on the Gauss meter. Now I'm looking at the top number, there's 30 on the Y. So if I back up to 30, I went from 46 and I have dropped all the way to 15. I had to move 30 millimeters in order to go up 10 Gauss. So that would be what this gradient is. If I write this down, this is roughly 30 millimeters at this point. Now when we go to 30 to 40, let's see what we get with 40. I went from the 15 and I'm coming down a little faster just to get us there, and I am right at 40. Now I went from 15 to zero and then about three below zero, so that would be 15 and three would be 18 millimeters. Now to go 40 to 50. We move down from 40 to 50. There we go, pretty close. All right, and that one went from the minus 3 to a minus 17, which would be a minus 14 or 14 millimeters. And then just one more, we'll do the 50 to 60. And going 50 to 60, you see how much quicker we get there, and we get to 60. And that would be at about a 26. So from 17 to 26 would be about 9 millimeters. All right, and so you can tell that's how much it's changing. These numbers are indicating what the gradient is. Now, I want to talk a little bit about how this gradient affects us on some of our applications. Our applications go like this. If I had a nail or a large piece of steel like this, it is experiencing the same magnetic field all the way across it. What makes the particle move in a magnetic field is the gradient. How much is the magnetic field differing across the particle? Now, you get a much stronger attraction if the particle or the piece of steel is aligned like this, because the gradient from this end is much greater, because this one is looking at a gradient that is just based on the thickness of it. And so you have to get closer, and you can take something like a needle or a nail, and you may have to get, if you're bringing the field down very slowly, you may have to get very close to it before it actually picks it up. Whereas if it's disoriented and it's just in a different pattern, it might pick it up an inch farther away. So we have to look at this. Now what we're fixing to look at, I wanted to just get the foundation laid. Then we want to talk a little bit about noticing the vertex, the vortices that we have that's caused by this gradient and looking at some particles that I have. For this next part, we're going to be looking at iron powder in a silicon oil. I have a medium viscosity silicon oil, and I have this iron powder. Now, this iron powder is very special. I have ordered this. It is 2 microns in particle size. The whole batch of it that I got is all 2 microns. The reason I wanted 2 microns is it allows me to study the fields, as you'll see in just a minute, a lot better than what we normally could. First, I want to show you, we're using this magnet. This is a 1.5 inch diameter, 1/2 inch thick magnet, and on the bottom of it, to focus it, get us a little bit stronger field, I have a 30 millimeter diameter and 1/2 inch thick magnet on this. So the first thing we're going to do is take this magnet off, and you get to watch this iron powder as it falls to the bottom, and it makes like a little explosion as it spreads out. We can turn it sideways, and it creates all kinds of really cool cloud patterns in there. But what we want to do is we want to shake it up. You can see all of this, and we're going to shake it up and spread that powder out. I want that 2-micron powder to be thoroughly mixed, because we're going to put the magnetic field on it. The viscosity of the silicon oil combined with the size of the magnetic particles, or the iron particles, makes it so we can see this in fairly good slow motion. So we're going to let it sit, and it takes about a minute for the fluid to stop moving. I want to get it down to where everything we see is the influence that we're having from the iron particles. And now, just to talk a minute about where we're at. We're going to be putting the magnet on top, and I want you to see this as it comes. We're going to notice in this region a vortex. You're going to notice a vortex in this direction, or going this way. And what's happening is you'll see a stream of particles going to the center. So this lets you know what we're going to be looking for. At this point, I'm going to go ahead and put the magnet on top and let it start clearing it up. In just a minute, when it gets enough of it clear for us to see this pattern, we'll take a look at it in more detail. But what's happening is, if you picture where the gradient comes in, if I'm taking a particle that's large enough, let's say it was 10 microns in size, then as this field acts on it and it orients itself, it creates what we call a torque that makes it turn and align itself so it's center of mass and is in line with creating a north on one end and south on the other, because it's ferromagnetic. And then it will start traveling towards the source of the magnetic field. As it moves through the gradient, and this is where the gradient comes in, as it moves through this, what it does is now this region on the front end is stronger and it keeps attracting to it. A second thing is taking place. What we see taking place at this point is the magnet, because of induced magnetic field, the fact that the magnet is turning this into a magnet gathers the field around it and makes it stronger. So as this gets closer, it becomes a stronger magnetic particle itself, and the magnetic field it's getting closer to is also stronger, so the attraction becomes stronger. And this creates an acceleration, because as it gets closer and closer and closer, it goes faster and faster until it hits the source of the magnetic powder. And you're going to see this as we take a look at this now. Like I said, I've got the magnet sitting on top, and it should be clearing this up in just a second. Yes, we can see this. So now you look in the center and you're starting to see an upside down tornado. And that tornado is like a vacuum that's pulling the particles off of the bottom and pulling it up. And it starts to get darker and darker because the concentration of the particles is so strong in the middle. Then on the outer edge, you're actually seeing particles, even though they are close to the magnet, instead of going towards the magnet, they are actually falling down. And if you concentrate on looking at this for a minute, you'll notice that it falls down, moves over, gets in line with that center stream, and goes to the center stream. Now, another thing happens with these particles. As 2 and 3 and 4 of these particles come together with a north-south alignment like this, they become longer, and that's why you'll see it forming little thin strings of iron particles going up. And you'll start to notice that the larger particles actually move faster because they have a greater gradient from one end of the magnet, the particles, to the other. As the mass increases, then the amount of force is increasing, which is also increasing the acceleration. When we get through with this, and this takes several minutes for it to completely clear up, or to not really completely clear up, but to clear up enough of this next part. But when it gets to this point, you'll notice that the speed changes tremendously, and we see a large region here and here of the particles that are by themselves. The 2 micron particles are separated. They're not attached to another particle. And the force from this field acting on a particle that small makes it move very slowly towards that. But at the same time, you'll see the stream where these particles are much farther away than what these little particles will be. And you wonder, why aren't these particles rushing to the magnet? I would think that if I had a particle here and a particle here, it would just go straight to the magnet. But it doesn't. And one of the reasons for that, I think, is that when we get in this region out here, the polarity has flipped because now the magnet is going like this and what the field lines are, and this particle is being repelled and it comes down because if you look at it carefully, you'll notice that it's actually going down faster than gravity would be pulling it down. But it doesn't go all the way to the bottom. It goes down, follows the field line, comes back to the middle, and goes up at that point. So now we can take a look at this as it's now beginning to clear out, and we can take a look again at this region all around in here where you see how cloudy it is, and you can tell that there's still a lot of particles in there. We actually still see some air bubbles in this case. In some cases, you might see some. Sometimes you don't. It just depends on how quickly they got together and bubbled up to the top. But this gives you a good idea of how the gradient affects the particles. Now, if I did this with particles that were 10 times that size, I've got iron powder that's much larger than this, but it's still a very fine powder, and I put it in the oil, and as soon as I put the magnet there, whoosh, all of it goes together. Because the particles are so large, they're just automatically attracted to it, and I don't get a chance to watch this. So getting the 2 micron particles was extremely important for me to be able to see the fields taking place and giving us this formation. So in conclusion, what we want to remember is that the size of the object that's being attracted by the magnetic field makes a difference. The orientation of the particle makes a difference in how it's going to respond to the magnetic field. But most importantly, we want to keep in mind what the magnetic gradient is doing. And this is why when you hold something in your hand and you get it near a magnet and the magnet feels like it pulls it out, and the closer it gets, the stronger it gets. This is why. Is because the gradient near the surface of the magnet is very, very high. And this is also, when we flip it over, we've had customers that did not need this high of a gradient because they didn't need that strong of a force. They needed a more uniform field out here. And the customer that does this, the type application for this, usually is something like an MRI. and the MRIs have to have a very flat magnetic gradient. And so we've designed several magnets that achieve high field strength, very uniform field within the space that they tell us they need it. It's not going to be that way once you get out past the edges because it gets extremely high. But in the middle, right in the middle, if they're operating there, we can keep it down within MRI specs using just permanent magnets. And so when you think about magnetic fields and the flux reading and the Gauss reading and the BR max, and you think of the temperature grades, this is just one more thing to keep in mind when you want your application to use magnets, and this is a very important part. So I hope you've enjoyed this video, and certainly would like for you to subscribe and watch our channel, and we look forward to hearing from you if you have any questions.